Good afternoon. Can you hear me? Yes. So General de Rouzier, chairman of the EU Military Committee, will debrief you on the meeting of the EU Chiefs of Defense, which took place yesterday and today. So I will give the General the floor, and after his intervention, we will have a question and answer session. Thank you. General.
Merci beaucoup. Thank you very much. It's great to be with you in order to express the various elements that were discussed by the Chief of Defense in the very important meeting that we had yesterday and today. There were many different topics that were addressed, and a very full agenda, because Chief of Defense have issues in respect to international situation, but also engagement that the European Union is doing, both in operations and in capabilities. May I just stress a few elements? One is that we were very honored to have the High Representative, Madame Federica Mogherini, who joined the Chief of Defense for a session dedicated to interact with Chief of Defense, give her first visions of how she plans to interact in defense matters, both military operations. She highlighted how much she was eager to go in the field, see civilians and military missions and operations. She highlighted how much she was eager to interact with the European Defense Agency. And she highlighted that she was also eager to hear from Chief of Defense what were their main national concerns from a military standpoint, and what were their expectations in respect to the European Union. We had an important part of the meeting, which was dedicated to partnership. I put this on the agenda of today's meeting because partnership is of great importance for us. In our missions and operations, it plays a key role. May I just highlight it with a few examples? Georgia, who currently in Central African Republic, plays a key role, as Georgia is providing on its own, within the EU4RCA mandate, the whole aspect of protection of Bangui airfield, which is le poumon, en fait, de l'ensemble de l'opération, mais aussi le poumon de la République centrafricaine. So it's very important, that commitment that they do. New Zealand has just chopped out, as we say, which means left, Operation Atalanta, where with a maritime patrol aircraft, they were performing alongside us, exchanging information within our Operation Atalanta. Turkey is a very large contributor to our operations in BIH, Operation Alsea. And so for all of those reasons, we first had a discussion on how to better continue to interact with those partner countries with whom we are side by side in operations and missions. There are also other countries with whom we want to continue and enhance our relationship. And this is why I have invited the Serbian Chief of Defense, General Ljubica Dulovic. Important because Serbia has played in our operations and missions a very key role, because Serbia is very much engaged in relationship with the European Union, but also with NATO, and they have made commitments to ISAF in Afghanistan. And so the interaction between our military forces and Serbian armed forces is of great value to Chief of Defense. And so for a dedicated period, we were able to interact with that Chief of Defense. We addressed another topic, which was related to transit strategies. Because in fact, we have now come to a moment where we are fully effective. And so we need to start to think about what is the next step. What will we do when we are fully effective in the training and advisory missions that we do in different places in Africa, as you know? What type of partnership will we have with those nations for whom the armed forces will have been reshaped and for whom the ministries of defense will have been advised in as a how to organize themselves. And so the transit strategies as a whole was a topic that we discussed. In respect to capabilities, we had strong, important discussions around two areas, one which I will not go into great depth because this is going to be one of the focus of next week's ministerial meeting, which is the policy framework document for enhanced cooperation. And I leave this, of course, to the next week's meeting to go into greater depths. But it is seen by Chief of Defense as one very important element that will allow to enhance cooperation. And you know how much cooperation in defense program is both difficult but also required and wanted by many Chief of Defense. We address in capabilities key projects, and I decided this time around to focus with one example, which is the remote piloted air systems, which allowed the Chief of Defense of Italy to highlight the way Italy operates RPAS, both in Italy itself and in the vicinity, but also in operations like they are currently doing in Operation Atalanta with us. Then there was a presentation by the EU military staff of where we stand in relation to the RPAS scenarios that the European Defence Agency has requested and that the military committee has tasked the EMS to come with elements which will be provided by the end of this year in view of EDA's work, which is preparing for the next generation of RPAS, next generation of drones, male drones. And so these scenarios will feed into that process. They will be useful in the sense that they will be scenarios decided at 28, so common view of how UAVs in the future should be used, could be used collectively. And finally, we had on that same subject the Commission, who highlighted the progress that is made in respect to allowing drones to operate within the mix of civilian aviation. And you know how much this topic is of importance. There's still a lot of work to be done, but progress is there. We addressed one topic which is related there again to air aspects. I had invited Mr. Patrick Key, the director of the European Air Safety Agency, EASA, and Mr. Raouha, from the Commission, the director, DG MOVE. Because Chief of Defense wanted to discuss the issue of single European sky, which, as you know, is a very important program with a lot of impact on the way that air assets, both civilians and military, will operate. And so Chief of Defense highlighted how much, from their point of view, they wanted to continue to be fully engaged in all the implementation of this program, which is about to have its first implementation take place on the ground. Then, of course, and I will finish with this, we addressed the various operations and missions. The operation mission commanders were there. We had a broad perspective provided by the EAS to highlight both in the broad Balkans and in Africa what are the various activities that the EU is doing. This was important for me to show to Chief of Defense the diversity, variety of all the elements that we can bring to the table when it is about dealing with a crisis or an issue. And so it was a way of to provide examples of what it is when we speak about comprehensive approach, a buzzword which is a reality and which highlights how much we can make progress and we can bring elements to the table. These are few elements that we had during this two-day meeting, very valuable, very useful. As you know, Chief of Defense are here, in fact, we should say, all the time, in the sense that they have military representatives which are here, and when they speak on behalf of the Chief of Defense. But these meetings, which take place twice a year here on the EU format, are of great importance. I would like also to say that General Knut Bartels, my NATO counterpart, was invited by me to attend this meeting, just as I am invited to attend his meeting, which in fact allows both of us to interact, as you know, how much NATO-EU relationship in has always been and is maybe even more so needed with the overall situation that we're facing around the world and within our own countries. With this, I'm more than happy to take any questions that you might have.
Thank you. Please, if you can just introduce yourself before asking the questions. There was a question here and there.
Okay, thanks. Yes, Brooks Tickner, Jane's Defense. Two unrelated questions, if I may. Progress on capability development has been very slow post-December summit, as the head of the PSC told us during the parliamentary hearing last week, and suggested strongly, too, that part of the problem, a big part of the problem is the militaries. Why is that? And will this change once you get this capability document that you referred to? I don't remember the phrase. Is that its intent to get the militaries moving on actual PNS projects for capability development? And secondly, Patrick Key was Mr. Cesar. Was he in there to brief you about the cost of Cesar for the militaries? At one point that was $7 billion. It seems to have dropped now to an estimated $3 billion. Did that come up? And do you know what the cost is going to be for the militaries for Cesar? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for your two questions. Capacity building, pooling and sharing, no one's to blame. Everybody's on the same boat, of course, and politicians make decisions. So it's not whoever, there's no one lagging behind. It's just that it is difficult. It is difficult to operate with each other in the sense that it is difficult to pool. It is difficult, why? Because first and foremost, armed forces, defense investment is made to defend a country, not a group of countries. And so this is what leads the initial decision process, political decision process. Yet we come at a time where there are areas where this is not possible. And this is what that document is about. It is, in fact, it highlights that there is a change of mindset for all of us. Of course, for the military, but for decision makers, political decision makers as well. It is thus because the situation demands, because with the diversity and strengths of the crisis that we're facing, it requires engagements by more than just one nation. So developing a defense capability for one nation is not sufficient. You need to be able to interact with others. Second, because defense spending in Europe is at the best at a standstill, if not reducing. And so in many areas, we are reaching, for some nations, so limited volume of capabilities that it cannot continue to operate without interacting with others. But there are many challenges. One of them is sovereignty, which is, I agree that on this aspect, sovereignty is not put at harm. And second, it's industry and investment and consequences of where the finance goes to. And so, of course, what is important is that this document, if it is agreed next week, will just highlight two things: political eagerness to change and change of mindset of everyone, and second, obligation to implement. And by next June, next European Council, there will be elements that will highlight that, yes, things continue, because we do a lot of interacting, continue to work. As for Mr. Patrick Key, who's the director of EASA, he's, as you're right, he used to be the director of CESAR. So he left to his successor the details of that specific program, implementing the technical aspect. But he was more on the broader aspect of all the work that the EASA does, one of which is the issue of certifying assets. And he highlighted how much he is engaged in certifying, of course, all and giving airworthiness to all civilian assets, but also to military assets like the A400M. And now he is starting, he has been asked to certify a UAV. So it was about highlighting to, on both sides, the willingness to interact, both between the EASA and with the Chief of Defense. And this is what I've been tasked by Chief of Defense to do in the coming months and to come back to them in May with highlighting the progress that we have made in those areas.
So the money issue wasn't discussed? That was just gone.
So money issue was discussed by the Chief of Defense, of course, as being one of the issue. But single European sky also brings a lot of advantages. It is not to be seen exclusively as a threat or a concern or something that will hamper, because it is first and foremost about allowing more effective flow of assets. And to some extent, it's more or less what we have in our own assets, which is a very good view of all of what is happening throughout the sky, bring this to civilian air transport elements and to aircraft. So we will get also a lot of data that can be very useful in the various activities, air policing being one of them.
Thank you. That was a gentleman.
Viktor Kolomiets, the special correspondent of Ukrainian television, the news channel 112. I'd like to ask you the next question. According to the information of NATO and Organization of Security and Cooperation in Europe, the situation in the east of Ukraine is continuing deteriorating and escalating. I'd like to ask you, what is your assessment of the situation in Ukraine? What information do you have? And what will be the reaction of EU Military Committee for it? Thank you.
On this specific subject, there was, of course, interaction between Chief of Defense and between us on what is occurring in the eastern part of Europe, in Ukraine and in the vicinity. But it is all about not having a military solution in this. But it is about the political process that needs to take place, about the truce that was decided to really be effective, so as to stop the activity that is taking place with all the consequences. And this is a subject that is, of course, going to be discussed in the coming days. It is here regularly at the political level. It is, of course, very much in the debate of Madame Mogherini, and it is for next week's meeting of defense ministers and foreign affairs ministers beforehand. For us here, this meeting, like all the meetings that Chief of Defense do, is about highlighting their concerns, which go also broader than pure EU aspects. And so there were, as you can imagine, a lot of discussions on this. But I cannot comment in any way.
But can you say, are Russian troops in Ukraine or not, according to your information? Because NATO says that yes, OSSE says yes, your information.
My information is that of the member states. The member states then express themselves through the European Council decisions. And yes, if you read the European Council decisions, you get a clear idea of what is the political position of the 28 member states. But there is no need to escalate through words. It's about discussions, and they take place in the right forum. NATO has made the announcements it considers is required. It is certainly not the chairman of the EU Military Committee or the EU body here, the military side of things, that will make any statement on this aspect, because it is very clearly stated by the European Council time and again, and the Foreign Affairs Council of next week will be another moment to highlight this.
Thank you. That was Nicolas.
Nicolas Grosvéret de Bruxelles de West France. J'avais deux, trois questions. Où on en est du dossier incitation financière et notamment la réforme du mécanisme Athéna? Est-ce qu'on a réussi à aboutir à une avancée, laquelle? Sur les battle groups, c'est à peu près la même question. Est-ce qu'on a réussi un peu à pas seulement remplir le planning, mais est-ce qu'il y a déjà un accord pour faire évoluer ce sinon le concept, au moins la fonction? Et sur la prolongation de Fort RCA, est-ce que vous avez tous les effectifs ou pas pour les trois mois à venir, enfin pour la prolongation du 15 décembre au 15 mars?
Merci bien. Merci beaucoup pour ces questions. Je suis désolé parce que je vais probablement vous décevoir. Mais sur les deux premiers, les progrès sont ténus, pour ne pas dire très très faibles. Pour autant, les préoccupations sont fortes. En effet, le processus de financement au sein actuel est efficace, mais largement perfectible. Et ça a été illustré de façon extrêmement claire lorsque justement on a parlé de la République centrafricaine et pour lesquelles le général Pontiès, le général Lyon sur le terrain, tous les deux veulent mettre en œuvre, dans le cadre de la phase de transition, veulent mettre en œuvre des actions civiles d'aide à la population. Et il y a les plus grandes difficultés actuelles par nos mécanismes de permettre à trouver le financement pour faire ce type d'activité. On va faire des progrès. On ne peut que faire des progrès parce que, comme le thème majeur en ce moment, c'est la transition strategy, la stratégie de transition, il est impératif que l'on arrête d'avoir des murs, des murailles entre nos différents secteurs d'activité. Et c'est la dynamique dans laquelle on est très largement engagé. Mais là aussi, comme sur d'autres sujets, il s'agit de faire évoluer les mentalités, évoluer et convaincre, car il faut aussi convaincre de la pertinence de ces actions. Et je pense que c'est ce qui va se faire à un temps assez proche. Sur les groupements tactiques, là, je crois qu'on a fait le tour de la question plus d'une fois jusque récemment, comme vous le savez, lors d'une réunion ministérielle défense. Et donc un débat extrêmement riche qui a eu lieu il y a quelques mois. Maintenant, c'est la vérité des événements qui verront si ce concept extrêmement efficace, qui permet la transformation des forces armées, permet des coopérations extrêmement élaborées, est-ce que celui-ci conduit aussi à pouvoir s'engager? Il y a un élément qu'il faudra prendre en compte, mais il est encore trop tôt. C'est les décisions qui ont été prises au sommet du Pays de Galles par l'Alliance Atlantique, pour laquelle, comme vous savez, 22 pays sont aussi à la fois membres de l'Union européenne et de l'OTAN. Et donc, concept pour le Pays de Galles qui vise à avoir une capacité de réaction extrêmement rapide, ce qui a bien évidemment des conséquences en termes d'organisation, de format et en termes financiers. Autant de débats qui sont en cours à Ever, en cours à l'Alliance Atlantique, et qui, après, vont conduire à des synergies qui se feront avec nous. Comme vous le savez, Madame Mogherini a reçu le secrétaire général de l'OTAN deux jours après son installation. Donc c'est dire combien la relation Union européenne-OTAN est quelque chose qui est très importante pour elle, pour nous. Et donc, par voie de conséquence, sur ce sujet spécifique, je crois que dans les mois qui viennent, on va être amené à avoir beaucoup plus d'interface. Et je pense qu'en mai prochain, sur ce secteur-là, je pense que j'aurai des éléments plus concrets à vous donner sur les progrès de l'emploi et de l'organisation des groupements tactiques. Pour ce qui est du Fort RCA, mission extrêmement importante, comme vous le savez, qui est prolongée jusqu'au mois de mars prochain. Le général Pontiès est tout à fait en confiance sur sa capacité à pouvoir assurer la prolongation de la mission jusqu'au 15 mars prochain. Il y a encore des discussions avec quelques partenaires pour voir quel type d'activité ils poursuivront avec nous. Et on est en train d'organiser aussi, et lui est en train d'organiser, l'interface avec les Nations Unies et le transfert vers cette mission des Nations Unies. Parce qu'en fait, cette prolongation jusqu'au mois de mars prochain de l'opération EUFOR RCA doit bien être vue comme étant une prolongation qui va permettre de faciliter le transfert vers les Nations Unies. Donc le même niveau de capacité ne va pas être maintenu tout au long du processus jusqu'au 15 mars.
Merci. Oui, s'il vous plaît, derrière.
Andrew Garner from European Voice. I think one of the missions you talked about was in the Balkans and therefore Bosnia. I think on the 11th of November, Russia abstained when it came to extending the mandate of the mission. How was that perceived by the chiefs of defence, and did that make you think about a potential exit strategy for security, for peacekeeping in Bosnia? And the second question is about Central African Republic. You mentioned transfer of responsibility to the UN. Was a UN official, someone from the peacekeeping mission, was he, department, was someone present? And what kind of evaluation is there at present about cooperation with UN peacekeeping forces?
I'll start by the second question, Central African Republic and the interaction with the UN. Interaction with the United Nations takes place on a daily basis, of course, in the field, so in Bangui. It takes place on a very regular interaction between here and New York, between the External Action Service and New York, through VTCs and other means. It takes place on a very frequent manner at different levels, one of which is, and most important, is the Ministry of Defense. And the Ministers of Defense, in their informal meetings, all of those I've seen in the last 2 months, systematically, Monsieur Hervé Latsou, DPKO, is attending those meetings, highlighting the importance that the EU and the UN takes in this interaction, so that he can not only voice his concern or his thanks to the commitment of the EU, but also to individual nations who do provide activities. And I do the same at my level during the CHOD's meeting. And last Chief of Defense meeting, Monsieur Hervé Latsou came, and it was a case a year before that. So I do this once every second Chief of Defense meeting. It is very important that we maintain this contact because we have a very strong ties together. As for BIH, there was a very strong satisfaction by the Chief of Defense that the mandate was prolonged through the UN decisions yesterday. And this means that they can continue to implement what is currently being done in BIH, which is very effective, and the interaction with the BIH armed forces is an element of stability and of interaction between European nations and the BIH authorities. And interaction takes place on a regular basis, and the PSC ambassadors, the ambassadors of the Political and Security Committee will be in BIH in the coming days, going to interact there.
Merci. Olivier, je crois.
Oui, général. D'une part, trois choses. La première, c'est sur la génération de force. Il n'y a pas que Fort RCA. Est-ce que vous avez entendu des promesses de l'un ou l'autre État membre pour Atalanta ou pour les autres opérations? La deuxième, c'est concernant l'amélioration de la coopération avec les pays tiers, avec les pays partenaires, comme vous avez dit. Par quelle mesure est-ce que cela passerait, si vous pouviez être un petit peu plus précis là-dessus?